my dear brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, it is not what we eat, but what we digest that makes us healthy. It is not what we earn, but what we save that makes us rich. It is not what we read, but what we remember that makes us learn. In the same way, it is not what I preach, it is not what you hear, but what we are going to practice that is going to make us a good Christians, a good sons and daughters of our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
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 My dear brothers and sisters, today's theme is just one sentence. We need to see as Jesus saw. We need to feel as Jesus felt, so that we can do as Jesus did. We need to see as Jesus saw. We need to feel as Jesus felt, so that we can do as Jesus did, my dear brothers and sisters. In today's gospel, we see a dumb man was brought to Jesus by some of his friends with the hope that Jesus could heal him. And here we see this man was having two kinds of impediments. The first one is he was not able to speak, and the second one is he was struggling mentally and physically, even spiritually, because he was possessed with the demon. When they brought him to Jesus, Jesus was able to heal him, and immediately he could speak. Immediately he was set free from the demon, my dear brothers and sisters. When this thing happened, when he was set free by the two kinds of impediments, we also see there were two kinds of reactions from the people. The first one is from the crowds, which we read, "And the crowds were amazed and said, 'Never has anything like this been seen in Israel.'" This is the first reaction. They were amazed. And the second reaction is from the Pharisees. What they were saying? They said, "By the ruler of the demons, he cast out the demons." One is positive reaction, another one was negative reaction. But surprisingly, Jesus was not bothering about these two kinds of people. The positive reaction was there. They were amazed. They said, "Never we have seen such thing in the nation of Israel." And another reaction was very negative. But Jesus did not bother. What Jesus was doing is, he moved forward. He was going to the different places, preaching the good news and healing the people and proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ about the kingdom of heaven. Here we have to understand, my dear friends, maybe sometimes we are like these positive people, complimenting the people. And maybe we are the people like finding the negative things in the people. Jesus was not bothered about these two kinds of reactions. He wants something more. He wants something deeper. He wants something commitment in the disciples, my dear friends. So thus I would like to say, there are four kinds of people in this world. The first one is complaints, those who give only the complaints. The second one is the compliment, those who give the compliments. The third one is commitment, those who are committed. And the fourth one is contribution, those who contribute something to the society, to the church, to the family, my dear friends. Complaints is the language of the children. No matter if you are a person who is always complaining about the church, about the priest, about the nuns, about your family, about the society, about the government, if you are a person who is only complaining, who knows only complaining, then whether you are 20 years or 30 years, 40 years or 50 years, no matter, you are just a kid. Complaints is the language of the children. Today we see the Pharisees. What they were doing? They were just complaining. This man was able to heal because he was helped by the prince of the demons. The second type is compliments. And we see the crowds. They were amazed and saying, never we have seen such things in Israel. So they were giving compliments. Also sometimes we will be the people who is just complimenting. This is very good. This is very nice. Excellent preaching. But the thing is, how far you are taking that preaching into your lives? How far we are practicing into our lives? We don't make any step forward to help the people who is doing something good. Here also we see the crowds. They were just giving the compliments. Very nice. We are amazed by your deeds. But they were not there with Jesus for a long time. So that is why Jesus was moving forward and he is seeking for the people who are committed. So commitment is the language of the matured people. Commitment is the language of the disciples. The fourth one is contribution. Contribution is the language of the enlightened people. Today, Jesus doesn't want the first two types. Those who are just complaining, those who are just complimenting. But he wants little more deeper. He wants those people who are committed for the word of God. Those people who are committed for the church to spread, to proclaim the good news of the Lord. And the last one is the contribution. We should be the people who contribute something to our families, who contribute something to our society, who contribute something to our parish, to the church in a larger way, my dear brothers and sisters. So we need to ask ourselves, are we the people only complaining or complimenting? We have to move a little more forward with the commitment to contribute something towards the society, my dear brothers and sisters. We need to see as Jesus saw. That's the first point that we would like to say. Jesus and the disciples saw the same scene. What was the scene? The crowds were approaching to Jesus. But Jesus saw them differently, whereas the disciples saw them differently. When Jesus saw them, he felt pity. He had compassion on them. But in the disciples, there was no the feeling of compassion. The same scene, but the way Jesus sees is different. The way the disciples sees is different. So today we have to learn. We need to learn how we must see like Jesus Christ, my dear brothers and sisters. What did Jesus see? Jesus saw the great need of the lost people. Jesus saw the great need of the lost people, which we read in today's gospel, chapter 9, verse 36. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Jesus saw the people as a sheep without a shepherd, my dear brothers and sisters. We have the former Pope Benedict XVI. When he was elected as the Pope, he told the people, all the people were looking for the good shepherd, but instead they got the German shepherd. There is so much of difference, my dear friends, between the good shepherd and the German shepherd. Good shepherd, what he does? He takes care of the people. He will have a care and concern towards the people. He will have a compassion towards the people. Whereas the German shepherd only simply barks and sometimes it bites. So we need to ask ourselves, are we the good shepherds, especially the priests and those who are in positions? Are we the good shepherds or not? If you are the good shepherd, you will have a care, concern, compassion towards the people, especially towards the weak people, especially towards the sinners, my dear fathers, my dear brothers and sisters. And we see in the Psalms 23, there the King David was saying, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want anything. King David was saying, the Lord is my shepherd. If the Lord is the shepherd, who must be the sheep? Who must be the sheep? David is considering himself as the sheep. He was the king of the Israelites. Though he was the king, he is saying, the Lord is my shepherd. I am the sheep. In order to be a sheep, my dear brothers and sisters, we need to have some special qualities. You know, among the animals, they have two kinds of instincts. Any animal you take, the first instinct that we see is they fight or they flight. If there is a situation where they can fight, they will fight back. If there is a situation that there is no chance of fighting, they flight, they go away. But sheep is the animal which doesn't know how to fight, which doesn't know how to flight. That means sheep is an animal which is totally dependent on the shepherd. We also see in the jungle, in the forest, we have the like wild dogs we have, wild pigs we have, wild buffaloes we have. Also at home we have buffaloes, dogs, pigs and so on. But wild ones are there in the jungle. But you never hear about the wild sheep. Because sheep cannot live without the shepherd. When sheep is apart from the shepherd, it dies. It is totally dependent on the shepherd. Now, when David was saying, Lord, you are my shepherd and I am your sheep, what David is saying here? David is saying here, Lord, I don't know how to fight. I don't know how to flight. And without you, apart from you, I cannot live. I will die. I am totally dependent on you. So the sheep must be able to say, Lord, you are my shepherd. And when you are with me, I shall not want anything. I am totally dependent on you. And he is saying, the Lord is my shepherd. He did not say the Lord is shepherd. He is saying the Lord is my shepherd. What does it mean by? What does it mean by my? My means the sheep and the shepherd have the relation. Only when they have the relation, you call a shepherd my shepherd. Sometimes people will go to the church and after coming back from the church they say, for God's sake, I did not understand even a single word what that priest said. For God's sake, I did not understand what that priest is doing. Which means, my dear brothers and sisters, you and your priest is not having relationship. When there is a relationship between the people and the parish priest, then you say, he is my parish priest. Or otherwise you will say, he is the parish priest. There is a lot of difference saying my parish priest and the parish priest. Shepherd and my shepherd. The problem can be either with the sheep, or the problem can be either with the shepherd, or maybe the problem is with both sheep and the shepherd. We have to rectify ourselves. And we must be able to say, Lord, we are sheep and you are my shepherd. And another important point in the Psalms 23 we see is, he's saying that he leads me to the green pastures to lie down. Isn't it? He leads me to the green pastures to lie down. In our lives also we need to understand, if somebody have to sleep, at least four needs are there. Somebody have to sleep comfortably, four needs are there. The first one is, when there is a fear, you cannot sleep. When there is a fear, suppose the sheep is here and there is a tiger, there is a lion there, will it sleep comfortably? No, because of the fear. Oh my God, there is a tiger, there is a lion, how can I sleep? So also in our lives, sometimes people will come and say, Father, I am not able to sleep the last night. And another one is, when there is a friction, you cannot sleep. Fear comes from far, but friction means, see, among the sheep there are two kinds, male ones and female ones. And among the male ones also there will be two types. Some will be okay, very nice. Another one will be ferocious. Wild ones will be there. What they will be doing? Every time they will be disturbing. So when there is a disturbance from the neighbor, you cannot sleep. So maybe friction in our lives also, there will be some people who will be disturbing us. Maybe your husband, maybe your wife, maybe one of your child. So somebody is disturbing from neighborhood, from your neighbor, then you are not able to sleep. When there is a fear, we can't sleep. When there is a friction from our neighbor, we cannot sleep. Another one is, sheep will have a fleece, you know, fleece. Every 6 months you have to cut it. Hair cut you must do. Otherwise, it grows so much, it will not be able to move. Sometimes it will become like a turtle, tortoise, and turns upside down. And if it turns upside down, within 11 minutes, the sheep dies. So it is very, very important that the shepherd should take care of cutting the hair, cutting the fleece of the sheep every 6 months. Otherwise, it will die. So when there is a fleece on the body, it cannot sleep. Heavy. And the last one is, when it is hungry, without food, it cannot sleep. So four things. The first one is fear. The second one is friction. The third one is fleece. And the fourth one is food. When David is saying, the Lord is my shepherd, and he takes me to the green pastures to lie down, to sleep well, comfortably, that means what he is saying, Lord is not only protecting me, but he is also taking care of me, he is feeding me. So when we have these four things only, then we will be able to sleep comfortably. And also he is saying that he will lead me to the still waters. There are two kinds of waters. The first type is running water. The second type is still water. The shepherd will take the sheep not to the running waters. Because if he takes to the running water, what happens? When it is drinking the water may go into the nostrils. And it will be irritated. You see, some of the sheep will be going and hitting to the wall. Or going and hitting to the tree, because there is an irritation in the head. Something is disturbing. So it dies also. So that is why the shepherd will take the sheep not to the running waters, but the still water, so that it can drink the water comfortably. These are the qualities, my dear fathers, my dear brothers and sisters, the qualities of the shepherd. The shepherd have to take care. The shepherd should have a compassion. Like Benedict XVI said, jokingly, he said, all the people were looking for the good shepherd, but instead they got the German shepherd. Let us not be the German shepherds. Let us be the good shepherds, my dear brothers and sisters. And the second one is, Jesus saw the great harvest of lost people. We read, the harvest is plentiful. The third one is, Jesus saw the great need for workers for the harvest. He says, the laborers are few. The harvest is plentiful, whereas the laborers are few, my dear brothers and sisters. It seems after the ascension of Jesus Christ, he went to the heaven. When he went to the heaven, he was still having the marks of the crucifixion on his body. Angel Gabriel saw that, and Angel Gabriel was saying, Lord, you loved the people so much, you loved the world so much, that is why you had so many beatings, so many marks of the crucifixion. Now I have a question. Does all the people of the earth know about you? Does all the people of the earth understood about your salvation plan for them? Then he said, no, not all the people of the earth. Only some people in Palestine. Only a few people in Palestine, they know about me. They understood my plan. Not all the people. Then Angel Gabriel said, then who is going to tell all the people of the earth about you? About your sacrifice? About your crucifixion? About the good news? Who is going to tell? You already came back to heaven, no? Then Jesus said, don't worry, Gabriel. I already told my disciples. I have 12 apostles. I told them, Peter, James, and John, to go to the different nations and proclaim about the good news and baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Then the angel Gabriel was shocked a little more and said, are you talking about that Peter who denied you 3 times? Are you talking about that James and John who were fighting for the positions? Are you talking about the Thomas who doubted about you? Do you trust them? Do you think that they are going to different places and say and proclaim the good news about you? It is better for you, Jesus, to have the second plan, to have the backup plan. Then Jesus said, Gabriel, I don't have any second plan. I don't have any backup plan. I trust Peter, James, and John, my apostles. And I trust that they will not let me down. So also, my dear brothers and sisters, after 2000 years also, Jesus is not having the second plan. As he trusted Peter, James, and John, when he trusted Peter, James, and John, other apostles, they did not let him down. They went to the different places, they proclaimed the good news, and they were all martyred. Also, Jesus is having the same trust on each and every one of us today. If you are a baptized person, we have the responsibility to work in the vineyard of Jesus Christ. It is not only the responsibility of the bishops, the priests, and the sisters. Each and every baptized Christian has the responsibility to work in the vineyard of Jesus Christ, my dear brothers and sisters. As I told you earlier in my daily reflections, the first two letters of God, what are the first two letters of God? G-O. What are the first two letters of gospel? What are the first two letters of good news? What does it mean? Jesus is asking each and every one of us, go, go, go and proclaim the good news and baptize the people in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit and make them my disciples. So this is the responsibility of every Christian, my dear brothers and sisters. So let me come to the conclusions. It is said that 97% of the world, it is said that 97% of the world has heard of Coca-Cola. No Coca-Cola? Coca-Cola. 97% of the world population has heard about the Coca-Cola. And 72% of the world has seen the can of the Coca-Cola. And 51% of the world population has tasted the Coca-Cola. But now, if Jesus wants his disciples to go and proclaim to the different nations, which he told 2000 years onwards, even till today, there were many people who have never heard about Jesus Christ. But the Coca-Cola came into existence only maybe 100 years back. So it is better for the Lord to tell to the Coca-Cola company, go to the whole world and campaign about me, tell about me. But God is not saying to the Coca-Cola company, he is still having trust on me, on you, and on everybody, that it is our responsibility to work in his vineyard, to go to the different people. And there are different things. Matthew summarizes the ministry of Jesus in three ways: teaching, preaching, and healing. And not all the people have the ability, the talent to teach in the public, but you can teach one to one. When I was working in the last parish in Guntur, Nambur, one of the Protestant lady, so by hearing the word of God from me, by inspirations, she was converted to the Catholic Church. Her name is Maria Rojamma. So after coming to the Catholic Church, what she was doing is, she was going to the different Protestant people, different Hindu people, going and teaching, going and preaching about the good news personally. She is not able to teach and preach in the mic, in the public, but she knows how to teach, how to preach, how to give the testimony personally to the people. Until today, around 15 people came back to the Catholic Church because of her. So we have to learn. We have to learn how to teach. We have to learn how to preach. We have to learn how to give our testimony. It is not that we have, all of us have the talent of preaching and teaching and healing, but we have to ask the Lord to give us the grace to preach and to give testimony. And finally, my dear brothers and sisters, we need to ask ourselves, how can we become more sensitive to the needs of others? How do we show compassion to the people who are in need? Am I working as the laborer in the Lord's vineyard, we need to see as Jesus saw, we need to feel as Jesus felt, so that we can do as Jesus did. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Saint Anthony, you live a simple life. Through prayer and devotion, in the silence of the morn. In loneliness and joy, you serve the poor. With gentle, caring, loving heart. Saint Anthony of Padua, we implore. Oh, teach us how to live the gospel way of life. You're chosen by the Lord to lead us on to the path of life. Simplicity, humility, and joy. The Spirit leads you on to preach the word, with visions of eternity and detachment from all things. You care and share with missionary zeal. You heal with gentle love alone. Saint Anthony of Padua, we implore. Oh, teach us how to live the gospel way of life. You're chosen by the Lord to lead us on to the path of humility and joy. We thank you, O most holy Trinity, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, triune yet one God. You gifted us with Saint Anthony to be your instrument of peace. Saint Anthony of Padua, we implore. Oh, teach us how to live the gospel way of life. You're chosen by the Lord to lead us on to the path of life. Simplicity, humility, and joy. To the path of life. Simplicity, humility.